Financing Commission to order. Dana, you can do the roll call.
Present.
Stephanie Como.
Present.
Mike Nifco. Todd Holzman. Bob Houston.
Present.
Dale Jacobson.
Present.
Ruth Johnson. Brian Mallory.
Present.
Dr. Montez.
Present.
Pam Shipley.
Present.
And Ernie Van Huser.
Here. Present is too long a word. Okay. Well, it looks like we have a quorum present for the transaction of business. The first thing on the agenda would be the approval of minutes for the April 25, 2012 meeting. Assuming everybody's had a chance to look at those. If you haven't, we'll take a minute, let you look at those.
I'd move approval.
Okay, we have
second.
A motion to approve. And a second. Okay. Do we have any discussion? Any corrections, additions? No? Okay. All those in favor of approving the minutes from the April 25, 2012 meeting, say aye.
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 All those opposed say no. Minutes are approved. The one thing in looking at the old minutes we haven't done is we haven't said the Pledge of Allegiance. We probably ought to do that. So if I get everybody stand and we'll say the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Went to an Optimist Club breakfast this morning. We've already said the pledge once a day, so twice a day is definitely enough. Okay, at this point, I would like to open the public hearing for the Third Amendment to the redevelopment plan for the 58 Highway West Extended Redevelopment TIF area. And I believe we're going to hear first from the city's incentive counsel, David Bushek.
Thank you. My name is David Bushek with the law firm of Gilmore and Bell in Kansas City. Our firm is bond counsel and special economic development counsel to the city. And I will start the proceedings with a brief procedural summary. I handle some of the procedural matters and give you a brief background on what's being proposed. First item of business is the procedural issue of entering into the record, the exhibits. And one of the documents that was included in your packet is a list of exhibits 1 through 16. These essentially prove up the compliance with the procedural notices and other matters that are essential to bring this matter before you this afternoon. So I'll enter those exhibits into the record. Brief history then of the Galleria TIF plan. The plan was approved in 2005. The plan has been amended twice. Most recently was the second amendment to the plan, and that approved Project 2, which allowed for the Sam's Club business to be constructed, and also authorized some additional reimbursements to the developer. There is a particular procedural rule that's associated with the proceedings this afternoon. In the original plan in 2005, called for four redevelopment projects, and three of those redevelopment projects have been activated by the city through the original plan and the amendments that I mentioned. The original plan called for a Project 4, which is approximately the 20 or so acres of property that lies to the south of what is now the Sam's Club development. But in the original plan, that was just a few references. It was basically a concept at the time that the plan was approved. There's a particular procedural rule then that comes into play, and that is what we commonly call the 10-year rule, which is all projects where TIF is activated, where TIF collection is activated, has to be approved within 10 years after the plan is approved. So looking at the timeline, that 10-year deadline runs in January of this year. January 23rd of next year is the 10-year deadline. So we're faced with a fairly unique procedural situation in that Project 4 has to be approved by that deadline, or it can't be approved permanently under the original Galleria TIF plan. So the developer's request is to approve Project 4 that has been included in your packets, delivered to the city clerk. And this is essentially a placeholder, for lack of a better term. The developer acknowledges that the document that they provided, which serves as Project 4, is speculative at this time. They don't have any particular tenants that they are negotiating leases with or purchases of that property. But because it's acknowledged that some form of a project has to be approved by ordinance before that 10-year deadline, that is the reason that we're here before you this afternoon for this hearing. In order to approve that project, we have to hold a public hearing here in front of the TIF Commission, and then your recommendation has to move on to the City Council, and the City Council has to act before that 10-year deadline. So it's acknowledged that the project, as it's been presented by the developer, is speculative in nature. It's essentially their best estimate of what may eventually develop there, what the total project costs are, and what their requested TIF reimbursement is. One of the items that we have discussed with the developer is an amendment that's occurred to the city's incentive policy. The city has approved an economic incentive policy that addresses a number of the economic incentive tools that the city uses, including TIF. And one of the items that the City Council has reviewed recently and has approved is an amendment to that policy that addresses what sort of factors and conditions the city should analyze when approving a speculative TIF project. Because we are, as I said, up against the 10-year deadline, we have started discussions with the developer about the items that are included in that list as it's been incorporated into the city's policy, but that's essentially a list of items for future discussion. So the ordinance that the City Council will consider to act on this activation of Project 4 will include a condition that the City Council's approval of this project is subject to the negotiation and execution of a TIF agreement to the satisfaction of the City Council that addresses all of those items that have been incorporated into the economic incentive policy. So in very general terms, what the TIF Commission typically reviews, as you are today, is a plan, or in this case, a plan amendment. And then when it comes time for implementation, the City Council will both act on the plan or the plan amendment, and will also act on the contract. And typically, the contract tracks hand in hand with the plan or the plan amendment. But because of the unique circumstances and that 10-year deadline that we're faced with here, it's acknowledged by city staff and the developer that that contract will be negotiated at a later date. And so the project that you're considering and the project that the City Council will consider is essentially a placeholder to preserve the option to use TIF subject to later negotiation of a TIF contract when the developer actually has tenants online and is ready to move forward with actual development. Another item that's of important note is when the developer actually has prospective development in this area, they've acknowledged that it's very likely that will have to come back before you for another amendment. There's three particular things by statute that require a new public hearing when you're considering changes to a TIF plan. Changes in the exterior boundaries of the redevelopment area, changes to the land use, or the third one, and this is the one that's important in our case, a substantial change to the nature of a redevelopment project. So we know that what's being proposed by the developer for your consideration and council approval is speculative. It's very likely that that will change substantially enough that that will have to come back before you for another hearing at some point in the future, and then we'll move on to the contract. So again, the action item that you're considering today is essentially a placeholder. It's the developer's best estimate at what may eventually go there, but we're going to be back in front of you with a future amendment when they actually have some development. That will be subject to negotiation of a more definitive contract that takes into account all of the items that are included in the city's incentive policy. So then for your consideration and action as a recommendation to the City Council, we've included in the meeting packet a resolution. This is the standard form of resolution that we typically prepare for you to act. It's written in terms of a favorable recommendation. So if you adopt this resolution, it would reaffirm the prior findings that the council made back in 2005 as it applies to the area that's proposed for this project for. I would recommend that the City Council by ordinance approve the Third Amendment before that 10-year deadline and activate TIF collection in Project 4, and then also enter into a TIF contract at the appropriate date to actually implement Project 4 when the time comes. So those are the procedural steps that we'll have to follow. And the question before you then is your recommendation on Project 4 as it's been presented by the developer. If you close your hearing and adopt this resolution at the meeting today, then the plan is to move this on to the City Council for action on the December 8th meeting, and I think the second reading of that ordinance will be on the January 12th meeting. So that's the schedule moving forward, and it will allow the city to comply with that 10-year deadline that we're facing regarding Project 4. That concludes my initial comments, and I think the developer also plans to speak and say a few points regarding what they proposed.
Anyone here to represent the developer? Would you please come forward?
Commissioners, thank you for your time today. My name is Steve James. Commissioners, thank you for your time here today. My name is Steve James. I'm with the Hush Blackwell Law Firm in Kansas City representing the developer. I have here today with me Mr. Ruben Pate, who's with the development team. David, I think, did a very nice job of kind of summarizing why we're here today. So I don't think I'll speak for very long. As he mentioned, we're kind of talking about a speculative project here. But as David mentioned, there is a fair amount of history to this plan, and it's a history that includes, I think, a lot of successes, a lot of partnership between the developer and the city to overcome some challenges, and a willingness to amend the plan with this commission and work together to overcome some challenges. We've obviously gotten a fair number of developments done out there, the Lowe's store and the Office Max early on. Then we had the economic downturn. We were able to come back and amend the plan with this commission and with the city to accomplish some of the good things out there, including the Sam's Club store and some of the new restaurants and retail you've seen out there in the last few years. So this, to me, is really an opportunity to preserve the ability to continue that partnership into the future and not let this 10-year clock kind of arbitrarily cut that off. As David mentioned, we do need to present some sort of project to you today in order to be able to satisfy the requirements of the TIF Act and activate a project. So what we've presented to you today, as David indicated, is sort of a best estimate of what we expect may occur out there. It includes approximately 240,000 square feet of commercial development to the south of the Sam's Club and Office Max site there along Dean Avenue. We anticipate that would include approximately $38 million in development costs, and if it develops with the user mix that we think, it would derive approximately $10 million in new tax benefits to all the taxing districts and $3 million to the city. Obviously, that's, like we said, speculative, so when we have an actual project, we'll be back here before you. One of the things that I think we have preserved in this plan and would expect to preserve in any future amendments is a 50% surplus pilot, so half of the new property taxes would be returned to the taxing districts. That's something that we incorporated into the second amendment to the plan and would expect to preserve that through this amendment and any future amendments. So as David mentioned, this is really a placeholder. We would expect to move forward to the City Council with an ordinance that requires the developer and the city to come together again and negotiate a TIF contract that would really set up the parameters for any reimbursements under this amendment. And most likely, we'll be back here before you with a plan amendment that kind of spells out specific users and specific components of a project down the road. So. With that, if there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer them, or I've got Ruben here as well if there's any questions about the development specifically.
Does anyone have any questions? Pam?
If no one has any questions in particular to the plan, I do have some questions in regard to the wording of the pilot payment. I am the county collector, by the way. In the spirit of consistency, whenever Plan 2 was put into place, and that also had a 50% pilot, I think you call it surplus, back to the taxing districts, the wording itself says that the county collector is to disperse those funds prorationally to those districts, but in a prior meeting that I had with the city of Raymore, it was an agreement, I believe, that the city would make that disbursement. So, in the spirit of consistency, the wording in this plan still references the county collector to disperse that 50% surplus pilot payment, and so I just think we need to word it the way we're doing it so that there's no questions.
Without a question, the city does act as the dispersing agent to all the agencies, and we should probably amend that accordingly. That goes all the way back to the MOU too with the ESB.
Okay.
One thought that comes to mind is if everybody's in agreement that should be, that change should occur to this document, an option that we have is, I'm thinking of the timing of this, as long as that change occurs, we have to send notice of any changes to this document before the City Council finally approves it by ordinance. And I think we, on the schedule, we have plenty of time to provide that notice. It's a 10-day publication and mailing notice to the taxing districts. So I'm sort of processing this right now. We would be able to change the document and provide the notices that are needed before the City Council finally acts in January. So we, in other words, yes, we could take care of that.
Sure, yeah.
Any other questions or comments?
Thank you.
At this time, we'd like to ask for anyone who'd like to speak in favor to come forward and speak. Anyone opposed to the matter, come forward and speak, please. Okay, doesn't look like there's anybody here for or against at this point, other than what we've heard so far. So in that sense, we will close the public hearing. I think we have done that. And at this point, the chair would entertain a motion to approve Resolution 2014-1 as presented, with the amendment that Pam Shipley has suggested and David Buschek has indicated could be done.
So moved.
Okay. Brian?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
One other clarifying question. What generally constitutes a substantial change for it to come back to us? What are the criteria for that?
There's a standard that our firm has followed for many years, and it's based on, there's not much case law on this issue, but it's based on our analysis, and there's one particular case over on the St. Louis side of the state that helps frame this. The rule of thumb that we have followed and that we advise our clients is if there's more than a 5% change to the primary number components of a plan, that's a substantial change. So looking at total project costs, total reimbursement, those are the two primary numbers. And if the change to either of those, the total project costs or total reimbursement, is 5% or more, then that crosses the threshold for a substantial change. That threshold used to be a bit higher, but based on the case that I mentioned from the St. Louis area, that essentially lowered our threshold to 5%. There's other factors that are relevant. If the layout of the site substantially changes, for example, if access points substantially change, traffic flow, things like that, those are also relevant, but the two sort of benchmarks we look at are those two primary numbers.
There we go. I should get turn on the microphone, right? We have on the floor a motion to approve Resolution 2014-1, recommending approval of the Third Amendment to the redevelopment plan for the 58 Highway West Extended Redevelopment TIF area and approval of redevelopment project 4. Any questions? Any comments? Hearing none, we'll call for the vote. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed say no. Motion's carried. Mr. Thompson, is there any other item of business to come before the TIF Commission? Okay.
Would now be an appropriate time to bring up another issue aside from the resolution?
Sure.
I don't know if, Mr. Buschek, if you're aware, there was some legislation that was passed. Have you all discussed?
Yes.
That, okay. It was just brought to me by my association, so I wanted to make sure I passed that along to you about the increase in tax levy. Okay.
Right. I wrote it, so.
Okay. Oh, you wrote, I actually said that you probably did have something to do with that, so. Okay, great. That's
okay.
All I had.
Just out of curiosity, could you fill us in on some of the details?
Well, since you wrote it, I'll let you do that.
It essentially provides that if there's a sales tax or a voter-approved sales tax or property tax increase, then the jurisdiction that implements that tax increase has to consent to TIF capture. So, for example, if the county voted to increase one of its taxes, the TIF that's already in place, whatever TIFs are already in place, would not capture that increase unless the county consents to it.
And David, would each taxing district that's within that TIF district have to approve if there's more than, I mean, each one who has the increase would have to approve that with the city that they're willing to forego their increase to
Correct.
The TIF?
Correct. So the jurisdiction that votes for the increased tax as a result of voter action would have to consent to TIF capture of that incremental increase in the tax.
And who would be responsible to make that happen?
Well, in the case of the county commission, case
okay,
of the
what
city.
If it was like the Raypec School District has a voter approved levy increase in this particular TIF, would that be?
The school board then. We'd look to legislative action.
We being the city would
right, the city would,
city
look
would
to,
reach out to that taxing district that had the increase to get the consent.
Correct.
So I would not play a part in that necessarily.
No, probably not. I'd have to take a look at the language to see if there's anything that points to a different conclusion, but I think it would be the city's job to approach the taxing district in that situation.
Okay. Then would it be the city's job to inform me as the county collector of the decision made, because I would have to.
Yes, you would have to. I don't know if there's, we really work through the mechanics of that, because I don't know if it's happened yet in any situation, but the answer is yes, you would get notice of that at some point.
Okay, thank you.
It would have to come to you, because the amount of the especially if the body wanted to keep the, for instance, the school district, if they chose to keep the entire incremental increase associated with the new vote, then that would drastically change the distribution that you're sending to us.
Yes.
Even the labeling of it would be different, because right. up to now, in most cases, you're sending us the entire 50% or 100%.
100%, correct.
Ago.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. So, David, you're the one I'm to thank for this. Is that correct?
Maybe the legislature.
Okay.
Okay. Any other comments? Any other discussion? Okay. So hearing no further business, we'll stand adjourned. Thank you very much for coming.